The use of poison gas is a defining moment in this conflict, one that puts the final end stamp on the 19th century Victorian romantic ideals of warfare. You can't pretend anymore when human beings are being treated, you know, the way you would treat ants with a can of Raid or some other insecticide. They didn't know what to make of this, but they figured out pretty quickly it was hell on earth. As one Indian soldier would write his father afterwards, "This isn't war. This is the end of the world." The end of the world, to some of these people at the Second Battle of Ypres, looked like a cloud of greenish-yellow gas that was floating across the battlefield so slowly you could actually walk ahead of it. Again, historian Eric Dornbrose, quote, "Stretching 6,000 meters along opposing lines and bellowing high up into the air, a thick, ghastly-looking green-yellow cloud of gas moved eerily and threateningly with the breeze across no man's land. The gaseous monstrosity took on a pinkish hue from certain angles as the descending western sun shone through it. Quote, 'Take a look at this, sir,' said one Canadian artillery observer to his superior as he stared through binoculars at what was coming towards them. 'There's something funny going on.' Then he dove for cover from the incoming shells. But just then the wind shifted, compressing the gas cloud over the Algerians, whose forward units were engulfed. The soldiers grabbed their throats, choking and writhing in excruciating pain from the searing chlorine gas. In minutes, many hundreds lay drowning in fluids given off by the lungs. Seeing this, others panicked, dropped their rifles, and ran, leaving a 6-kilometer gap in the line." End quote. Private William Quinton, a British soldier, experienced his first gas attack only about a week after the first time it had been used. That affair had caused the high command to tell the troops to soak flannel in water and just put it over their noses as a cheap, easy attempt to try to forestall the gas. But none of these soldiers knew what they were facing until they actually, you know, had a gas attack hit them, which Quinton had hit him on May 1st, 1915. Quote, "Suddenly, over the top of our front line, we saw what looked like clouds of thin gray smoke, rolling slowly along with a slight wind. It hung to the ground, reaching to the height of 8 or 9 feet, and approached so slowly that a man walking could have kept ahead of it. Gas! The word quickly passed round. Even now, it had no terror for us, for we had not yet tasted it. From our haversacks, we hastily drew the flannel belts, soaked them in water, and tied them round our mouths and noses. Suddenly, through the communication trench, came rushing a few khaki-clad figures, their eyes glaring out of their heads, their hands tearing at their throats as they came on. Some stumbled and fell and lay writhing at the bottom of the trench, choking and gasping, whilst those following trampled over them. If ever men were raving mad with terror, these men were. What was left of our section still crouched at the support end of the communication trench. Our front line, judging from the number of men who'd just come from it, had been abandoned, and we now waited for the first rush of Germans. But they did not come. Our biggest enemy was now within a few yards of us, and in the form of a cloud of gas. We caught our first whiff of it. No words of mine can ever describe my feelings as we inhaled the first mouthful. We choked, spit, and coughed. My lungs felt as though they were being burnt out, that they were going to burst. Red-hot needles were being thrust into my eyes. The first impulse was to run. We had just seen men running to certain death, and knew it, rather than stay and be choked into a slow and agonizing death. It was one of those occasions when you do not know what you are doing. The man who stayed was no braver than the man who ran away. We crouched there, terrified, stupefied. A large shell burst on the parapet just where we were sheltered. We were almost buried beneath the falling earth. Young Addington, a chap about my own age, was screaming at the top of his voice and trying to free his buried legs. He got free, and before we could stop him, he rushed off, God knows where. We then saw the reason for his screams. His left arm was blown off above the elbow. He left a trail of blood over my tunic as he climbed over me in a mad rush to get away." End quote. Quinton and his unit of Canadians will block heroically the hole that develops in the line, keeping the Germans from breaking through. Private William Quinton and his unit will move up to the front line and will experience the aftermath of what the gas attack did to the people who first encountered it. He wrote, quote, "Black in the face, their tunics and shirt fronts torn open at the necks in their last desperate fight for breath, many of them quite still, while others were still wriggling and kicking in the agonies of the most awful death I've ever seen. Some were wounded in the bargain, and their gaping wounds lay open, blood still oozing from them. One poor devil was tearing at his throat with his hands. I doubt if he knew, or felt, that he had only one hand, and that the other was just a stump where the hand should have been. This stump he worked around his throat as if his hand was still there, and the blood from it was streaming over his bluish-black face and neck. A few minutes later he was still, except for occasional shudders as he breathed his last." End quote. As I've said before in this program, and I think I will say many times more, this is the most horrifying, sustained situation of terribleness I've ever seen soldiers forced to endure. And millions of people will get to experience this before the end of the conflict. My own grandfather would be gassed on the Western Front, and he was never the same afterwards.